Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Colors of Culture, The Beauty of Diverse Friendships by MelindaJoy Mingo, narrated by Machelle Williams. Introduction. We are living during a time in our society when fear and mistrust among people of different racial groups are becoming the norm rather than the exception. Acknowledging that there has been a huge resurgence of racism, discrimination, and individual prejudices is difficult and even baffling at times. The cultural divide appears to be expanding rather than shrinking. Although we have made great strides in learning how to connect with people beyond our discomforts and fears, and to see others as God sees them, as people of value and worth, if we are honest, there is still much work to be done. Cultural mistrust does not only come from our obvious differences, such as race or lifestyle. How we treat each other as individuals and our perception of each other both play a role as well. At a recent town hall meeting in my city to discuss what steps we can take to understand each other better, a young woman stated, "I thought we were past all this divisive stuff. I think we have fear of each other, and we have to learn how to trust and respect each other again." It was an uncomfortable meeting, with raw conversations centered on the role of law enforcement in our city and the mistrust among communities of color due to both national and local events involving blacks and community policing. A courageous conversation took place in a room filled with people who barely knew each other, but wanted to begin the necessary process to move beyond shallow words and mistrust to building bridges instead of walls. That one meeting has initiated many more in our city, and friendships have formed between the most unlikely people. They would never have happened without people being willing to take steps to pursue understanding each other. While we do have some heartbreaking problems happening daily in our society, regarding interactions between diverse populations, it is my belief that we have solutions that will take courage to move beyond our places of comfort. But these solutions are not as complicated as we make them. What can we do? We can learn to see every human being from God's perspective as persons of worth, value their lived experiences even when we don't understand them, and cultivate genuine relationships based on humility, vulnerability, and transparency. If we are not willing to get real about our own heart issues with people from different cultures and backgrounds, and if we don't allow God to bring healing, nothing will change in our lives or in the lives of those we interact with daily. Sometimes it's easier to ask Jesus to change the situations around us, rather than transform ourselves and allow the change to begin within us. Almost every African Bantu dialect includes the saying, "I am because we are," which is captured by the term Ubuntu. The word literally means humanness and roughly translates to human kindness. The concept of Ubuntu is that no matter our differences, we as human beings can connect with one another through sharing our life experiences, stories, and humanity. We all have stories from our journeys in life, and our stories and lived experiences are the heart of who we are. Even though our life stories do not always connect with the stories of others, they are an important summation of our personal experiences, of why we believe as we do, and ultimately our frame of reference and our perspective of others. My first introduction to the term Ubuntu came through a fascinating picture of a group of people with linked arms running together to get a small basket of sweet treats. Just enough treats for one person, really. A caption explained that the group had been told that the person who reached the basket first would get the treats. When they were asked why they ran together instead of individually, their response was, "Ubuntu. How can one of us be happy if the other ones are sad?" I was still puzzled by why they would run together when there was only one prize and why that would make them genuinely happy. I also wondered what that all had to do with culture and relationships. I finally got the message when I read the following words by Archbishop Desmond Tutu, which are a rich description of how we should ultimately connect with any person from any culture. It is the essence of being human. It speaks of the fact that my humanity is caught up and is inextricably bound up in yours. I am human because I belong. It speaks about wholeness. It speaks about compassion. A person with Ubuntu is welcoming, hospitable, warm, and generous, willing to share. Such people are open and available to others, willing to be vulnerable, affirming of others, do not feel threatened that others are able and good, for they have a proper self-assurance that comes from knowing that they belong in a greater whole. They know that they are diminished when others are humiliated, diminished when others are oppressed, diminished when others are treated as if they were less than who they are. The quality of Ubuntu gives people resilience, enabling them to survive and emerge, still human, despite all efforts to dehumanize them. When genuine warmth, respect, and honor are displayed, not merely for aesthetic purposes, but out of genuine love and compassion for others, in other words, out of Ubuntu, a journey toward transparency, understanding, and long-lasting friendships is enabled. From this idea, an idea evolved around my passion and love for seeing people from different cultures and backgrounds unite. I called it genuine Ubuntu relationships, the willingness to see every human being from God's perspective and not through the lens of prejudices, stereotypes, and negative societal influences. These Ubuntu relationships are not just about being warm and fuzzy with people from different cultures. They involve understanding that a common bond exists between us all, as well as differences that we don't need to fear. Our stories prove that, although we are diverse in our perspectives and different from each other in very unique ways, our differences should not keep us from the things we have in common as followers of Christ and as human beings. We all experience joy and laughter, trials and triumphs, fear and trust, pain and disappointment. We ultimately become unified when we are willing to walk together, as uncomfortable as it might be, and not allow barriers such as race or class to make us forget that we really do have a lot more in common with each other than we believe. Whether in our neighborhoods, churches, workplaces, or other spheres, community is built when we intentionally choose to come out of our comfort zones and connect to others without feeling like we are walking on eggshells. It means risking everything that we think we know about other cultures. It involves not getting stuck in fear and being willing to initiate small steps toward befriending someone. It takes honesty to admit that even as followers of Jesus, we can dislike people we know very little about because their values and beliefs are opposite to what we think or believe. But treating someone with dignity means seeing them as someone who deserves to be communicated with in a spirit of respect, even if we don't agree with their lifestyle or beliefs. To truly connect with people who are different from us will take the grace of God. When we are willing to learn what dignity, honor, and respect look like in different cultures, we not only positively affect diverse people in their communities, but we allow Jesus to work in our hearts as well. And through this bond of humanity and the pursuit of understanding each other, we discover our own identity. We also gain a greater understanding of what is written in the Bible about responding to those around us with love first. Jesus reminds us that the second greatest commandment is to love our neighbors as ourselves, and he will help us learn how to do that. It is doubtful that any solitary person can reflect God's character on their own. God's image comes to expression in community, and especially in our friendships with others. The journey of soul growth doesn't occur in isolation, but rather through our relationships with others, as our lives collide in our everyday dealings in a broken and hurting world. The truth is that relationships as a whole can be a bit messy, and learning how to truly relate to others takes time. But I believe most people are looking for genuine relationships and community. And relationships can be very beautiful and rewarding and reflect the heart of God for all humanity. How to use this book. The first part of this book explores the connection between culture and identity and helps bring clarity to ideas about history, cultural identity, and bias, and humility. When you are open to building diverse friendships, you are also willing to go beyond surface layers to pursue true understanding with others. I hope this book will help you be more aware of some of these layers. This section includes a chapter about God's heart for diversity, grounding our relationships in Jesus and the Bible. The second part of the book provides a way forward, giving practical steps for applying the concepts covered in Part 1 and forging stronger, diverse relationships. Throughout both sections are my own stories of the beauty of diverse friendships and how God has worked through them. My desire is that this book will be a guide for and bring encouragement to those who feel stuck but who desire to live out the beauty of God's diversity in their relationships. There are sections at the end of each chapter called a pause moment, which offers questions that can be used for personal reflection or group interaction. Because people often come to conversations about diversity with different definitions of words, I want to clarify a few before we start. I use the term culture to refer to specific and notable attributes of an individual or a group of people that distinguishes them from other groups. The term worldview refers to a network of ideas, feelings, and assumptions that gives a frame of reference to an individual or a group of people and shapes the reality of what they think, feel, or do. Finally, the words ethnicity and ethnic groups refer to a community or population composed of people who share a common cultural background or descent. This book is a compilation of real stories and examples of people who embody the concept of Ubuntu relationships. The stories involve love, forgiveness, missed opportunities, and second chances. Some parts of the stories are messy. They reveal the reality that building relationships includes many obstacles and challenges, some of which are real and some of which are imagined due to our perceptions of different cultures. But I didn't want to write a book that would only highlight problems. I want to share real-life stories of what it looks like for Ubuntu relationships to be lived out even when the people involved didn't get it right the first time around. I wanted to show how relationship mistakes can become learning opportunities. For these reasons, I have risked being transparent in sharing my stories, my successes, and my failures. And I have received permission from others to share their stories. However, for their privacy, names and identifying details have been changed. The impact of historical racism, present-day cultural tensions, different life experiences, and differing personal values and beliefs in our 21st century postmodern society have led to many misunderstandings among people of various cultures. But building relationships with others does not have to be complex if we choose to walk in humility instead of posturing ourselves over any other culture and simply enjoy the journey of doing life together. To do life together is to find commonalities that are shared with someone, and from those commonalities begin to appreciate our differences. Journeying through this book. As I wrote this book, I came face to face with old patterns of personal bias and prejudice. I also struggled with the desire to not offend. I have had to take my own pause moment to reflect on what I have learned throughout life, and what I continue to learn through a journey of personal racism and discrimination, rejection, and injustices. I have also had to earnestly look at my negative actions and behaviors toward, as well as words about, other cultures, and not just what I have experienced. Living out the fullness of the gospel means I have to stay true to what I believe about relationships with my friends from other cultures and not be persuaded by others' perspectives and experiences or anything that I see or hear in society today. As you listen to the book, I have a request. Take a deep look within your soul at your current relationships with individuals from different cultures and assess if they truly model the example of Jesus. Ask God to rekindle a passion and joy in your heart as you develop skills for being a cultural champion. Someone who learns.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.